Join Dr. Cheryl Tilner as you learn to identify a variety of edible and medicinal plants. Your knowledge will quickly grow as you take advantage of her experience as an accomplished herbalist and a naturopathic physician. She is also founder and owner of Wise Woman Herbals, an associate editor of the newsletter Medical Herbalism, and lectures throughout the United States. You can join Cheryl now on this exciting journey into the world of plants.
We're walking out of a densely forested environment of mostly deciduous trees, but some evergreens. The area we're coming into is a brightly sunlit meadow. The plants we'll find here will be a variety of plants that either like partial shade or plants that like full sunlight. The bush that I'm right next to, here on your right, is Rubus parviflorus, otherwise known as thimbleberry. This plant also has another common name known very well to backpackers. The other name is toilet paper leaf, due to its incredible softness. Not only is it soft, but look at the size of this leaf in comparison with my hand.
The thimbleberry's large lobed leaves have significant venation on the underside with ragged teeth on the edges. Due to their size, they were used by the Native Americans to wrap berries and other food for storage. They also ate the young sprouts in the early spring, while older leaves were used internally as a medicine to strengthen the blood in some types of anemia. Externally, the powdered leaves were used to hasten healing and decrease scarring of burns and wounds. The five-petaled white flowers with many stamens are indicative of the rose family. This green, unripe berry becomes scarlet-colored when it ripens. They can be eaten fresh or used in the same way raspberries are prepared as jams, pies, wine, and other tasty treats. Personally, this is one of my favorite wild berries to eat fresh right off the bush. This next shrub is also in the rose family. Rubus spectabilis, or salmonberry, is its name. This plant can be sparsely or thickly thorned. The reddish-brown bark shreds on the older shrubs and is easily removed. The Native Americans used the bark and the leaves in the form of poultices applied to burns and infected wounds. The early spring sprouts were used as food. The leaves are divided into three coarsely toothed leaflets. The magenta-colored flowers are a spectacular sight to see. These golden, or salmon egg-colored berries, are thimble-shaped like the thimbleberry, but slightly more elongated. Their taste is somewhat watery, but pleasant. They are best eaten fresh.
One of the plants that we'll find growing along the forest here is Galium aperine. Galium aperine is a very gangly looking plant. As you can see, there's a big mass of plants back here, and it's hard to tell exactly what it is. However, what it's doing is it has these long strands that are growing, basically crawling all over all the rest of the plants here. This thing may be as much as 10 feet tall if we took it all out, growing all over the area, and it looks like it's choking the other plants out, basically, is what it's doing. This plant has a variety of different names. It's called cleavers, bedstraw, goosegrass, and badge of the forest. One of the names, badge of the forest, was gotten because of its ability to stick to your body, which, by the way, is how it spreads its seeds around.
The entire plant is covered with hooked bristles. You can feel them on the quadrangular-shaped stems, the leaves which are arranged in whorls around the stem, and on the small round seeds. When ripe, the brown seeds of Galium can be roasted, ground, and consumed as a beverage with a similar taste to coffee. In fact, both Galium and coffee, or coffea, are in the same family, the madder or Rubiaceae family. The entire above-ground part of the plant is used medicinally. It's picked when the plant is flowering. The fresh plant can be juiced, made into a tea, or a fresh plant tincture. The plant can be dried for later use, but loses its medicinal qualities rather quickly as it ages. Galium is most often used for inflammatory states of the urinary tract, febrile conditions, and to increase urination. It's astringent, meaning it's drying and causes contraction of tissues. This is valuable to decrease bleeding, inflammation, and to tonify boggy tissues. It is also a vulnerary, which means it's soothing and healing to mucous membranes. Additionally, it's used to lower blood pressure, decrease fevers, dissolve urinary tract stones, as a general alterative, and as a pelvic lymphagogue. Galium is specifically used for kidney and bladder infections, stones, and prostatitis.
We're standing amongst a small patch of Trifolium praetens, otherwise commonly known as the red clover, and Leguminosae, or the legume family.
Red clover is a perennial of short duration. Each plant has several erect stems with long petioles or leaf stems on the lower leaves, with the petiole length decreasing towards the top of the plant. The leaves consist of three elliptical leaflets with minute teeth on the margins or sometimes smooth edges. The leaves may or may not have a whitish crescent near the center. The flower head is magenta pink, red, or purple. This plant has a long history of medicinal use. The part commonly used is the flower head with the top two attached leaves. The flowers are picked at their peak of beauty. When they start to turn brown, it's too late to harvest them. This herb can be used fresh or dried. Dry flowers should retain most of their color. Red clover has been used by numerous cultures to treat various malignant growths or cancers. It's primarily used as an alterative, antispasmodic, and for its mild sedative but tonifying effect on the nervous system. Specifically, it's used for bronchitis, whooping cough, and other spasmodic coughs. It's also used to prevent blood clots due to its antithrombotic effect. Externally, it's used to promote healthy granulation of damaged tissue such as found in ulcers, burns, and other wounds. This plant makes a pleasant-tasting herbal tea. Plus, it's nutritious due to its high vitamin and mineral content.
We're in a shaded environment under deciduous trees. The plant we're going to look at can grow both in the shade or in a sunny area. The plant's name is Arctium lapa, commonly known as burdock. The family it's in is the Asteraceae family. We're really lucky because we can look at both the first year growth of this plant right here beneath us, or the second year growth here to our side. This is the first year Arctium lapa, or burdock, here before us. There's one plant, two plants, three, four. You've got about four plants that you're seeing right here below you, all shooting all these different leaves out. The leaves are extremely large. Look at the difference here at this leaf and my hand. They're in kind of an arrow, like an arrowhead type shape, and the edges are a little bit frilly. The veins on them are quite large. If you look at the back of the leaf, you'll get an idea of the veination and just how strong they are. Also, along the veins, there's a lot of hairy fuzz. Also, all over the back of the leaf. In fact, that's what gives it this lighter green, pale type green appearance and a comparison with the other side of the leaf that's almost virtually non-hairy.
The leaves are nutritious but not very palatable. The leaf stalks and the pre-flowering flower stalk can be peeled and steamed like asparagus or eaten raw. Notice the red coloration at the base of the leaf stalks.
We're now taking a look at the second year stage of burdock. You can still see that these plants here have leaves around the base of them as we were just looking at in the first year plant. However, the difference is that these plants have created a main stalk that has risen up with leaves also off of the side of it. These leaves are alternate leaves, meaning they are alternate. They're not opposite from each other, but they alternate on the stem, rises up, and at the very top of the stem is going to be a flower later this fall.
And what a gorgeous flower it is, with purple stamens and white styles. This fall beauty will soon be the bountiful bearer of many seeds. The spiny flower heads become a seed capsule with hooks which catch onto your clothing or an animal's fur to travel to distant places. Although the entire plant has been used medicinally at one time or another, the root and seeds are most commonly used on this European import. The seeds have a direct effect on the urinary tract, increasing kidney activity, specifically urine output and elimination of waste products. Chronic use of burdock seeds or ingesting too many of them can cause urinary tract irritation. They are also used to increase liver and digestive function, as well as a general alterative. The root can be harvested at two times of the year. In the fall, if the plant is in its first year, such as this one before you, or in the early spring, if it is a second year plant like this one. Never use roots from a second-year plant with a flower stalk, as the plant is nearing the end of its life cycle and moving its energy out of the root and leaves into making seeds. The root can be used fresh or dry. It's used to increase urination, sweating, and bile production, to stimulate and facilitate digestion, as well as an antimicrobial, a liver tonic, and alterative. Burdock root is specifically used in skin diseases, for instance, acne, eczema, psoriasis, and boils. It's also beneficial for bronchial irritation and coughs, as well as used for muscular and articular rheumatism and gout. It acts on the urinary tract just as the seeds do, but in a milder manner. Besides its use as a medicine, the root is enjoyed as a food. You will find it in health food stores as burdock and Asian stores as gobo root. Burdock root has a sweet, slightly mucilaginous initial taste, which turns to a tad bitter but not unpleasant flavor. I've even made burdock cake out of the root, using it in place of carrots in a carrot cake recipe.
Gaultheria chelone, or salal as it's more commonly known as, is a plant whose berries were used quite a bit by the Native Americans. It's in great abundance, especially here in the Northwest. This whole area right here is covered with a huge patch of salal.
Salal is in the heath or Ericaceae family. Its delicate and sticky white or pinkish flowers will become a black, slightly fuzzy fruit. The leaves are very astringent, which led to the Native Americans using them externally as poultices applied to burns and other wounds. The fruit was widely used by Native Pacific Northwesterners. It preserves well as a dried fruit and was made into large 10 to 15 pound cakes by mixing dried berries with enough fresh berries to hold the cake together. It made a hearty meal when mixed with meat or dipped in oil such as whale or seal oil. The fruit is fleshy but also contains an abundance of seeds. This bright annual is Matricaria recutita, or German chamomile in the Asteraceae family. It's commonly used in herbal medicine as an antiseptic due to its antibacterial and antifungal nature. It's specifically been shown to inactivate bacterial toxins. It's also used as a diaphoretic to increase sweating and decrease fevers, a diuretic to increase urination, an antispasmodic, a vulnerary to heal inflamed and damaged tissue, a nerving, and an anodyne to ease pain. These numerous attributes have bestowed a myriad of uses upon chamomile, such as its uses for indigestion, colic, ulcers, diarrhea, menstrual cramps, toothaches, earaches, and headaches, insomnia, nervous irritability, fevers, flus, colds, and sore throats. It's used externally as a bath or compress to heal wounds. It decreases swelling due to its anti-inflammatory action and enhances new tissue regeneration via increased oxidative phosphorylation. A chamomile vapor inhalation can improve respiratory tract infections. If a little thyme is thrown in with it, it enhances its antimicrobial effects, opening the sinuses and easing spasmodic coughs. For those of you unfamiliar with herbal vapor baths, we will demonstrate how to make a simple herbal inhalation with chamomile. First, boil 4 quarts of water. Pour the boiling water into a large pot, adding 1 to 2 handfuls of chamomile flowers to the pot. Let it steep with the lid on. Remove the kettle's lid after 1 to 2 minutes. Cover your head with a towel or blanket, inhaling the steam in deep, long breaths. Other herbs high in volatile oils can be used similarly, or a few drops of the essential oil can be used instead. This blue bonneted beauty is Borragio officinalis, or borage in the Boraginaceae family. It has been said that the mere presence of this herb can comfort the heart and make the mind glad. Indeed, this elegant and delicate creature seems to exude a sense of peacefulness and joy. The flowers are often used in salads, where they brighten up your meal as well as your mood. Some people candy the flowers, while others use this mucilaginous treat as a herbal medicine in pulmonary complaints and to lower fevers. The leaves, stems, and seeds are used to stimulate milk flow in nursing mothers. The seeds are picked in the late summer and fall. The leaves and stems are picked in the early spring as the plant begins to flower. As you can see, the stem contains an abundance of moisture. The taste is pleasant. It smells and tastes similar to cucumber. Besides their use as a galactagogue to increase milk flow, the leaves and stem are used as a diaphoretic to increase sweating, an expectorant to help remove phlegm from the respiratory tract, an anti-inflammatory, and a diuretic to increase urination. This plant is thought to especially promote the activity of the kidneys and the adrenal cortex.
This patch of greenery in front of me is called Symphytum officinalis, commonly known as comfrey in the borage or boraginaceae family.
If you recognize the family name, it's because borage, the plant we just met, is also in the boraginaceae family. Comfrey is a stout, erect plant. Like borage, it's very hairy and has hollow stems. The flowers hang in curved clusters. They may be creamy yellow, purple, or rose pink. Although comfrey prefers partial shade, it thrives anywhere. Once you plant it in your yard, you may never be able to eradicate it. Even the tiniest piece of root will grow a new plant. This plant has historically been used as a food for humans and animals alike, as well as extensively used as an herbal medicine. However, before extolling its many virtues, I must tell you of its possible toxicity. Comfrey contains pyrrolizidine alkaloids, which have been implicated in hepatovenoocclusive disease. It's suggested this plant be used only externally, or if used internally, it should only be used short-term. Before using this plant internally, please study the pros and cons of the situation thoroughly so you can make an educated decision. The external use of this herb is what it is famous for. It is prized for its mucilaginous content and a particular constituent called allantoin, which speeds healing of damaged epithelial tissue or skin and hastens the callus formation of bones under repair. It makes a great external compress or herbal bath to use for sprains, bruises, ulcers, wounds, burns, hemorrhoids, etc. I prefer to use the root externally, as the leaf and stem have hairs which can irritate the skin when applied topically. To make a compress, mix the root with a small amount of water. Not enough water will create a lumpy, unusable mass, and too much will create an herbal bath rather than compress material. Once the mixture is blended, it can be placed on a piece of gauze or cloth and applied directly to the skin. Alternatively, you can make a comfrey slurry or bath by adding more water to the blended comfrey. I've seen comfrey baths heal cracked and battered skin of construction workers and gardeners' hands when nothing else would help. This slurry can be used cold or heated. Soak the body part for 15 to 20 minutes. If immediately refrigerated after using it, the comfrey slurry can be used repetitively for up to 4 days. The last few plants we have looked at are more oftenly found in the garden rather than wild. This plant is also frequently cultivated. Its name is Linum usitatissimum, or flax, in the Linaceae family. It's a delicate annual with 5 slightly overlapping pale blue flower petals. Besides its use as linen for clothing and bedding, it's also used for its mucilaginous character as a medicine. It's soothing, softening, and healing to irritated mucous membranes. Some specific uses for it are the respiratory tract, GI, and urinary tract, where it decreases inflammation and pain when taken internally. It's also used orally as a bulking and lubricating agent in cases of chronic constipation. The part of the plant used is a seed. The ripe seed contains 30 to 40% fixed oils, including linoleic, linolenic, and oleic fatty acids. It also contains about 5 to 6% mucilage. It's a source of linseed or flax oil. The use of flax oil has become quite popular lately as it contains essential fatty acids which are not always adequate in the standard American diet. You'll see it being used in a variety of health regimes for many different illnesses. The oils and mucilage act as a laxative, the mucilage making the stools more voluminous, while the oils have a lubricating action. It usually takes a few days of eating 1 to 2 tablespoons of crushed or ground seeds 2 to 3 times a day with 1 to 2 glasses of water to get the desired effect. Ground flax can be added to applesauce or oatmeal, but it's important to take those 1 to 2 glasses of water with each 1 to 2 tablespoons of flax, or you can increase the constipating effect rather than decrease it. Ground flax goes rancid rather quickly, so keep it refrigerated and never store it for more than 1 week. Ground flax is used externally as a poultice for boils, carbuncles, and infected wounds for its drying effect. It's one of the best poultices I know of to draw out slivers of wood or broken glass. It also is used as a poultice for its soothing effect in such instances as shingles or psoriasis. The best time to harvest your ripe flax seeds is in the fall, from the ripe seed pod. The use of herbal poultices has been mentioned previously. Since flax is quite often used as a poultice on infected wounds and to remove foreign objects from the skin, we will demonstrate how to make and use a flax poultice. Add one or two handfuls of flax seeds to a nut and seed grinder. Grind it for about 30 to 45 seconds into a fine powder. Pour this powder into a dish, just enough to use on the area of the body that you need to cover. The powder is now mixed with enough water to moisten it, but not so much water that it becomes runny. Flax should always be used freshly ground when taken internally. However, when used externally as a poultice, it's acceptable to use powder which has been stored as long as it does not smell rancid. Flax poultices are incredibly drying. They generally pull out slivers of glass within a period of 2 to 3 days. While using them on infected areas, they draw the pus right out of the area. The amount of flax to apply depends on the area afflicted. Cover the entire area in question with flax. Then cover the flax with a bandage. After a period of 12 hours, the entire poultice can be removed. This process can be repeated as many times as necessary, each time allowing 12 hours for the flax poultice to dry before removing it. This strong-smelling perennial plant is Chrysanthemum parthenium, or feverfew in the Asteraceae family. The aromatic smell is due to the essential oils in the leaves, one of them being camphor. This plant is an anti-inflammatory, a diaphoretic to increase sweating, an anodyne for pain, and an antiseptic. It's used for arthritis, parasites, fevers, colds, and its big claim for fame to prevent migraines. I should tell you this plant has been known to cause contact dermatitis and allergic reactions in some individuals. Many people use it every day to prevent migraines, eating fresh leaves. Some say they need to eat the leaves between pieces of bread like a sandwich, or they can cause mouth sores. These sunny flowers are Calendula officinalis in the Asteraceae family, a common garden annual with bright orange or yellow flowers, blooming from May to October. The large flower heads are solitary up on each stem. They have a strong but pleasant aromatic scent. The beautiful petals make a delightful addition to garden salads. The entire flower head, or just the ray petals, can be used. Carotenoids create the beautiful pigmentation in these flowers, which have been used as a dye in a variety of products such as cheese, cloth, and soap. Although the whole plant has been used medicinally, the flowers are the primary part of the plant used. They are picked prior to pollination. As with most Asteraceae family plants, this can be accomplished by picking them when the ray petals are pointing straight up towards the sky, before fully opening. Medicinally, the flowers are used as an anti-inflammatory to decrease inflammation, a vulnerary to promote quick wound healing, an antimicrobial to reduce the possibility of infection, as well as their ability to decrease the formation of scarring. In addition, calendula flowers act as a choleretic to promote the production of bile in the liver, a cholagogue to promote the flow of bile from the gallbladder. It's no wonder this plant is famous for its use in minor surgery, especially in its form as a succus. Besides minor surgery, calendula is used externally for incisions, lacerations, burns, ulcers, bruises, and sprains. Because it promotes quick tissue regeneration, you may not want to use it on puncture wounds or infected wounds which need to be drained. Orally, calendula is used as a systemic adjuvant to the local action in wound treatment, but its main internal use is in cases of capillary engorgement, such as hemorrhoids or varicose veins. It's also used in cases of old ulcers and splenic and hepatic engorgement. I've additionally used calendula flowers in herbal douches, eye rinses, and in making soap. Next, we will learn how to use calendula flowers to make an herbal soap in your own kitchen. The first thing we need to do to prepare to make our herbal soap is to create calendula oil. Calendula oil is very easy to make. Collect together a blender, dried calendula flowers, and oil. I use extra virgin olive oil when making medicinal oils, and either the olive or sweet almond oil for soap making. Fill your blender with about 20 ounces of oil. Add the dry calendula flowers, blending them thoroughly. Pour the mixture into a container. Keep blending oil and flowers to get as much herbal oil as you need. Assume there will be a little over half the volume of herbal oil in your final product as what you see presently. Make sure you have a couple inches of oil over the top of the flowers at all time. This jar is shook once per day for 2 to 6 weeks, at which time it is pressed. The length of time the mixture macerates, or sits, depends on how warm the room is. On hot summer days, it'll be ready in 2 to 3 weeks. In the winter, 5 to 8 weeks. Although I generally prefer using a cold maceration method, herbalists have come up with a variety of ways to speed this process up, such as sitting the oil beside a hot wood stove on cold winter nights, or putting it in your car on a sunny day. A crock pot on low is an alternative method. My favorite story is a woman who told me she took her oil to bed with her every night to keep it warm. Good thing that lid didn't come off in the middle of the night. When finished, strain the mixture through a sieve. The remaining oil in the flowers can be pressed out using a cheesecloth or another type of thin cloth, such as a tea towel. You may press the oil out by wringing it with your hands, which is very laborious, or alternatively, the oil can be pressed out with a small juice press, which takes much less effort and produces more oil as a final product. Once the herbal oil has been pressed, it sits for a minimum of 24 hours. This allows the debris to settle to the bottom of the jar. Notice how the oil has picked up the pigmentation of the flowers. It's beautiful. Now, in the final stage of this process, the oil can be filtered through cheesecloth, leaving the sediment behind in the bottom of the jar. Our calendula oil is now ready to use. To make calendula soap, you will need to gather together the utensils and products you see on the screen. The first step is to make a calendula tea. Boil 5.5 cups of water, turn the burner off, and add 5 cups calendula flowers to the pot. Cover the pot with a lid and allow the tea to infuse until the liquid is at room temperature. Strain the tea. Put your gloves on for this next step, as the lye we will use can irritate your skin. Take our cooled tea and add 13 ounces of lye or caustic soda to the tea. This must be added outdoors or in a well-ventilated area, as breathing the vapors can damage your lungs. Even when mixed outside, you need to be careful not to breathe the vapors in. This mixture will immediately get very hot. Use a candy thermometer to measure the fluid's temperature. It must cool down to 75 degrees before you can use it. While the calendula tea lye blend is cooling, we will go to the next step. Heat 3 pounds of coconut oil. When it melts completely, turn your burner off and add 3 pounds of calendula oil. Use a candy thermometer to measure the temperature of the oil. It needs to cool down to 85 degrees. While it is cooling, take the ray petals off of calendula flower heads to add to the soap as a decorative effect. When the oil is 85 degrees and the lye tea mixture is 75 degrees, you are ready to mix the two of them together. This mixture will need to be stirred for 10 minutes up to an hour. At some point, it will thicken to the consistency of pudding. At this point, it is ready to be poured into the molds. Be very careful not to get any of the liquid on your skin. The molds should be well greased ahead of time. Stainless steel containers, wooden boxes, or plastic can be used as a mold. If using plastic, make sure it's strong. Tofu containers make fabulous soap molds. Fill your containers with the soap and let them sit for 12 to 24 hours. Now wash everything that came in contact with soap, as it's still very caustic and we don't want to leave a trace of it anywhere. After 12 to 24 hours, cut your soap into the shapes you desire as a finished product. In 24 more hours, you can carefully pop the soap out of its mold and get them on a table to air dry. Turn the soap every few days so all sides are exposed to the air. They will be ready in 2 to 4 weeks. You can tell by touching them to your tongue. If they're not ready, it will sting a bit. When they're ready, it'll simply taste like soap. Now back to the garden to meet Tropaeolum magus in the Tropaeolaceae family. Nasturtium, as this plant is commonly called, is native to Peru, where it's used to heal wounds. This plant has very long-stemmed rounded leaves. The stem terminates in the center of the leaf, as opposed to most plants whose stem ends at the base of the leaf. As you can see, the flowers are also quite distinctive. This plant is a great plant to grow in your garden. It will brighten up your yard as well as provide you with fresh food and medicine. The fresh leaves and flowers are the parts used both as a tasty tidbit and as a medicinal herb. This herb tastes very spicy, and as a medicine, it's a powerful antimicrobial used externally for infected wounds, and internally, it's specifically used for respiratory tract infections.
This plant here before us is Rumex obtusifolius yellow dot
in the buckwheat or Polygonaceae family. This common wild perennial can also be found in your garden, although it's usually an uninvited guest who traveled in on the wind. Both the root and the leaves are used medicinally. The part of the leaves used most often are the tender young shoots. Due to their mucilaginous character, they make a good demulcent to use externally for skin irritations such as insect stings or bites, diaper rash, cuts, abrasions, etc. Internally, the young leaves are used for coughs as a soothing demulcent, especially dry, irritative coughs. When using the young shoots externally, they are best applied directly to the skin as a fresh poultice. If you've heard about using yellow dock on nettle stings, this is the part of the plant to utilize, the young shoot. The mucilaginous shoot is administered directly on the skin. The entire plant is used as an alterative, mild astringent, cholagogue, and a mild laxative. The root is the part considered the strongest and used the most often. It's used for skin conditions such as psoriasis and boils, also for gastric distress with irritations and flatulence, rheumatism, hemorrhoids, as well as some cases of jaundice. Yellow dock is thought to promote the uptake and or the ability of the body to utilize iron. As with most roots, the best time to harvest it is in the fall. The root can be used dry, but loses its